Hi, Peter here from URender. In this video, I will show you how to create this scene from scratch. All the assets you need are free and linked in the video description below. First, download all the content you need. Go to the Quixel homepage and in the free section you can find this rock asset. The environment map can be found on our homepage urender.com. Go to Downloads, Examples and Assets, and download the example HDRs. I will use the Wood 3010 HDR. Switch to the content browser and open the VEGBot. In Cinema 4D Release 20 and lower, he can be found in Studio, Example Scenes and Character Examples, and in Release 21 you can find him in the Example Scenes Character Animation directory. You also can use the search bar. First of all, change the render engine to URender and then convert the Cinema 4D materials to URender materials with the Material Converter. You can find it in the Extensions or Plugins menu and also in the Material Editor. Then activate Live Mode and check the result. We will tweak the materials later, after we created our light setup. Here on his left fingers there is a little issue. It seems that the normals are inverted. We can fix this on the mesh directly by flipping the normals, or we play it safe by adding an URender object tag on the entire VEGBot group and deactivate backface culling. In this case, all polygons are rendered two-sided. Copy your VEGBot group into the clipboard. I prefer to have a clean project with all textures in one text folder. The fastest way to do this is to use Save Project with Assets. This saves the model and all its containing textures. Just copy and paste them into your project folder. Also copy the textures from the Quixel model and the Wood environment map. So let's continue with a fresh new scene and save it in our project directory. Paste the VEGBot into the scene and also merge the high density FBX from the Quixel download. It's a 9 billion poly object, so this takes some seconds. Okay, we need to scale it a little bit up, but before we do this, I will set up the panel layout. Set URender as render device and activate URender live mode. You can change the resolution of the live mode here in the dashboard if you want. Scale up the ground object. Create a new URender material, assign it to the mesh. And let's see what kind of textures we have. There is an albedo and cavity texture. You can imagine a cavity texture as ambient occlusion map for high frequencies and fine details. So I will mix them together with the albedo texture by using overlay blend mode and 50% opacity. The textures are 8K and it will take a second until they are loaded. Next, we assign the specular texture and roughness texture. And finally, the normal map. We are going to stage the robot now, so I will assign the floor to a new layer and lock it. That prevents selecting it while working with the robot. Oh, also set the X-ray button in the Basic tab. Otherwise, we may get problems to see and grab control objects from the rig if they are below the mesh. So let's find a nice place and let the robot be sitting on one of those rocks. Maybe he is tired and needs a little break. The character's rig is really very good and nice with many useful controls, so it's a great fun to work with it. That's good enough for now. I create a null object and parent a spotlight. When moving the light in negative Z, you can control the position of your light by tweaking the null object. Always assign a URender light tag to get access to all features URender provides. I decrease the bias values as well as the sample radius. One of the most important things when working with URender is to use a good environment map. Activate image-based lighting and adjust the rotation of the environment. When using IPL, I recommend to activate ambient occlusion too. Using FXAA makes anti-aliasing with very less cost for a performance, so let's use it. I think I will make a common resolution, 1080p, and also set this to live mode resolution. You can adjust the scale value so URender doesn't render a too large resolution for the small live mode window. Now create a camera tag and set the far clipping plane. I will check some of the materials because it seems that they might be a little bit too glossy. In this case, the used texture is set to 45% mixed strength, so we can adjust the overall roughness with the roughness slider. I will also do this for the other materials. I want to have some more rocks in the distance, but I won't duplicate the high-res object. The Quixel assets come with several low-poly versions, so it's better to use them instead. Scale it up, assign the rock material and position it. Seems that the rocks are cut off, so we need to increase the far clipping of the camera a little bit. I also will adjust the render cam position. Let's say that is the camera view we like. To keep on working, I set my render camera view on the right panel, so I can freely work on the left one. One more lighting iteration. Increase the intensity of the light and the cone angle. Set a larger shadow map size and further decrease the absolute bias, so we get much more details for the shadows. Vagbot's left foot needs to be higher, and I think the shadows should be a little bit sharper. Now let's add up some clouds with volumetrics. First, you need to activate them in the render settings. Then create a volume object, set it to cube and adjust the size. If your performance in the live mode window is getting too slow due to the volumetrics, you can deactivate the enable live mode anti-aliasing mode. That makes the volumetrics more crispy, but it's a lot faster. Note that this only concerns the live mode and not rendering in Picture Viewer. In Picture Viewer, this setting is always active. Let's move the clouds up. And then activate a noise in the volumetric object. When playing around with the values, I recommend to set the contrast to maximum and lower it later when you are happy with the shape of the clouds. I want to avoid showing the volumetrics very far into the distance, because that would cost voxel resolution and performance. So I just rotate the volumetrics cube, then it comes closer to the horizon. You shouldn't overdo it, because the clouds would get visually too flat. I increase the clipping plane of the camera a little bit more. Don't be afraid of the dark clouds that are not lit by the spotlight. After the next few steps, that doesn't really matter. Adjust the density of the volume object and activate volumetric shadows. That allows the clouds casting shadows onto the ground. I'm not so happy with the pattern of the clouds. It would be nice if we could move them around. One good way to do this is to manually set a moving object. Just create a null, set the noise space to custom, and drag the null object into the noise transform slot. Now you can move the null around and find a pattern you like more. I will adjust the environment rotation to get a nicer gradient for the background. Our simple fog in the render settings is a good way to combine the sky with the ground. Use a blue color and adjust the density and the background strength slider. Increasing the persistence of the volumetrics will add more fine details to the clouds. Last steps, I will set tone mapping, will check super sampling, and add some slight post-processing effects. Be very careful when increasing the black point value of the tone mapping to avoid clipping to black. Finally, you also can increase the resolution of the volumetrics. Well done! Now you just need to make a nice idle and camera animation and you are ready. Thanks for watching.